come in. Said to bless him, ate and run. Amen.
That's okay.
But God's good. Amen. I'm glad we're on our way to heaven.
Amen.
Amen. Wouldn't it be awful if this is all there was?
Yes.
With its heartache and worries and trials. But thank God for the child of God.
Amen.
We've got peace everlasting.
That's right.
Amen. Would you stand this morning? Let's just invite the presence of the Lord. Amen, amen, amen. Appreciate each of you. Love you. And if you've got a special need, if you just raise your hand and let us know. Amen. God sees. Let's just pray for each of these instances that God will intervene for them. All right? Let's pray. Father, we love you today. We thank you and praise you.
There's love.
That's right.
Not everybody's made up their mind.
Right.
But I'm telling you, if we make up our mind to be faithful to the Lord, to surrender, to live, you know, with the end in view.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Amen. If we'll live with the end in view, God's going to take care of us,
yes,
and we're going to be all right. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Mighty good singing. Appreciate each one of you. And love you a bunch. Good to have our visitor with us this morning. And want you to just let the Lord have his way in your heart and life. And I pray that God will minister to our people, each of us,
yes,
today that are here, that we can make a more resolute commitment to the Lord about being faithful and doing his will than we've ever made before. You know, we start revival next Sunday. And I know we've been praying and fasting. And I want to say I really appreciate each of you that have been taking part in that. I'm telling you what, I can tell a difference. There's just been sweet, sweet spirit around here. And I appreciate the Lord for it. Tonight we're going to have the secret sister reveal. And I know the ladies are just anticipating and beside themselves with all that and everything. But I want God to minister today. Amen?
Amen.
I want him to have his way. I want to say we appreciate you, those of you that are giving thought to the revival financially and monetarily. Just do what you can. Set aside a certain figure if you can. And God will bless you for that. I mean, you know, Brother Boggs and them, we tried to send them an offering and everything during their little deal. And I'm telling you, they supported missionaries during that, you know, the pandemic and everything, when everything was seemingly shut down. But just because things are crippled a little bit, they don't have to stop. Amen?
Right.
We can still give as given unto the Lord. And
right.
God will bless you.
Right.
Amen for it. All right, we're going to come to you for the Sunday morning tithes and offerings and just ask you to just glorify God today. Amen. Amen. Your giving.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord Jesus. Praise the Lord. If you got your Bibles, turn with me, if you will, to Matthew chapter 6. Chapter 6. You know, and going to be ministering to you this morning on choosing the hereafter over now, making right choices. We see in the first part of the chapter there, they're talking about giving alms, and in verse 9 it goes into the Lord's Prayer, and then verse 16, he talks about praying and fasting. And then verse 19, he said, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. Verse 21 says, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. And then in verse 24, it goes down and says, you cannot serve God and mammon. Verse 25 and 26 is my text today. It says, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat, or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? Behold the fowls of the air. For they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? And then verse 33, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Praise the Lord. God help us to seek the Lord with a full and fervent heart today. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we love you, Lord. We thank you and praise you for all you're doing, for what you've already done. God, we know you're faithful. Lord, we know that you're petitioning the Father, Lord, in behalf of our needs today in the fulfillment of the will of God in the church today, Lord. And I pray, God, that we would be representing ourselves in a way that pleases you. I pray that everybody that sees us would see, God, that we love you and we love human beings, God. Lord, let us realize that they'll know that we're your disciples, Lord, by our love. By our love, they'll know, God, that we're your disciples by the love that we bestow upon one another and upon those that are out in the world. Help us to be faithful, to love God in a way that pleases you. God, never to lust or covet after, God, what somebody else has, but help us to have to give. Lord, I praise you and I thank you for all of it in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. Praise the Lord. You can be seated this morning. Amen. You know, there's all kinds of things that get our attention today, and things that would pull us away from the Lord. And I read about a man, he was a minister, I believe in England, but his name was Edward Irving. And I didn't write the whole story down or everything, but as he was a baby laying in a wooden cradle, they said that there was a hole over here. And he learned to look through that hole over here. But he so trained his eye to look over here to where he could look two ways at once. He could be looking straight ahead, even a little bit to the right. And he could be looking over here to the left at the same time. His peripheral vision was phenomenal. But he had a real focus. You know, he could look two ways at once. And then Mr. Bunyan wrote about a man he called Mr. Facing Both Ways. Facing Both Ways. And there's a lot of people that, you know, they got one foot, so to speak, one eye in heaven and one eye on the earth. And there's a lot of us that are not that way, but if we're not careful, we'll get so much attention down here. We'll be thinking about so much about what's going on down here until we will forget the promises that are made about up there. Forget that the things of God are yea and amen. I mean, this is not something that can be changed. The blessed book is going to come to pass. It's going to come to fruition. Just like God said it. We've heard for years. I read the back of the book and we win. And we can't forget that. We've got to remember that we win. Amen. We win in the Lord. Amen. What are you saying, Pastor? I'm trying to say today that, brother, there's a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. But if you and I will set our eyes on the prize, if you and I will look toward heaven and be faithful to God and let God accomplish our ways, amen, His ways in us and through us for His glory, one day soon we're going to be home, amen. We're going to be where we're longing to be, amen. We're going to be with the Lord. But there's a lot of people today that are professing they're going home. They're professing they're going to heaven. But brother, I'm telling you, they're sincerely professing while sincerely doing something else, contrary-wise. And I'm amazed at people that sound so convincing, so sweet, so loving. And you say, well, Pastor, you're biased, and you give them the benefit of the doubt, and you just love them extra much and everything. And I do. I love them. Some of them are my family members and extended family members, and I do love them. But I want you to know it really don't matter how much we think we love somebody or not. The world is going to know whether they love God or not, whether they love the brethren, whether they have the love for the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Right. And I'm telling you, the person that's saying in their mind and saying with their lips that they love the Lord Jesus Christ, and they've got all in their heart against the body of Christ, whether it be a preacher, whether it be in Virginia, or whether it be in Florida, or whether it be in Colorado, or whether it be in Texas, it's irrelevant, brother. I'm telling you, you don't hold on in your heart against those that love God and those God love, and stay right with God.
That's right.
You got to get it prayed through.
Amen.
You got to get it prayed through. You may think that everything's okay, and it may think like that everything's going to work out all right, and everything's going to be fine. But I'm telling you, there's a way that seems right.
That's
wrong.
Right.
Amen. There's a path that seems like it's the way we need to be going. Some are choosing wine, women, and song. Some are choosing dance and vice and pleasures of sin for a season. But I'm telling you, you are what you are today by the grace of God.
Yes.
And He deserves every bit of the glory for any good thing that ever comes to you or from you. Amen. A lot of people are trying to cheat and shortchange God and trying to, you know what I mean? They're trying to really cheat God and the devil. They're not really very good sinners, and they're not really very good Christians. Well, what does that mean, Pastor? You figure it out. I don't know. I mean, I had to work out my salvation. You work out yours. And I'm not trying to be arrogant or anything in that. I said that here in a service not too long ago, and I grieved over it for 3 or 4 days or a week because my attitude probably wasn't where it needed to be. But I think, my goodness, we are mature Christians in the Lord, and we don't need to be being offended, and we don't need to be being upset. And a lot of these things we should have settled a long time ago. We used to say, you know, I don't smoke and I don't chew and I don't run with those that do. And I know that we've got some that are listening in, and they're going to say, well, he's shooting at me while I'm not here. He's not shooting at you. He's trying to obey God.
Amen.
That's all. He's trying to obey God. Every time I'm up here and I say something, when it gets uncomfortable for you, you realize, please realize, it's already got uncomfortable for me. Amen. Why? Because I don't know your business.
Right.
All I know is what God lays on my heart. And when I've got 3 or 4 or 5 pages of notes, and I get up here and I begin to rattle it, I've been praying all week, God, please lay on my heart what the people need. God, please minister effectively.
That's God.
You don't need to be looking both ways.
No.
You don't need to be looking both directions at the same time. It's either clean or dirty.
Right.
It's either good or bad. Yes. You say are there exceptions? Yeah, there's exceptions, but I mean, what are you calling an exception? You know, there's the will of the Lord. It may seem like, well, the devil don't lie all the time. I mean, he didn't lie all the time to Eve. He lied enough to get her damned and headed for hell to fulfill his word to where Jesus had to come and die on Calvary's brow for the sins of mankind. And I want you to know, everybody that's been born on planet Earth apart from Jesus Christ was born headed for hell, except for Adam and Eve. And it didn't take them long to chart the course in that direction. God was withholding some good thing from them. The devil said, God does know that in the hour you eat this, you'll be as God, knowing good and evil. You know, some things we don't need to know.
Right.
Amen. It's like that briefcase. Somebody sent something this week, and their 7-year-old, or a friend of theirs, I guess, acquaintance of their 7-year-old, brought the tablet to them, and there was a lot of stuff going on, and it was sin and immorality and degradation and sodomy and all kinds of things going on in that 7-year-old mama. And it was a problem, but the piece, the tablet, the whatever it was sorting out to the kid. And the parents would get on there and it wouldn't come up. And they tried for 40 minutes that night to get it to come up, and it wouldn't come up. The next morning, the mother turned it on like normal, doing her hair there, and handed the thing to the little kid and just stood back over here. And she said, within moments, there it was again. And you couldn't hit the X and it disappeared and go off. You had to watch it. And it was a minute and 40 seconds or whatever. I can't remember. But it was men kissing men, and it was sodomy and all kinds of immorality. And it was okay to have infidelity in the home and the marriage. And it's okay to be deceitful in the marriage. And I don't want to exaggerate. I don't want to get to where I'm just exaggerating to prove the point. The point is, we're living in a wicked, vile world. And we better keep our eyes on the prize. We better realize, brother, that there's a way that seemeth right unto a man. But the end thereof are the ways of death.
Right.
We've got all kinds of tools that help us in this world. This Bible has been called God's Heaven's Roadmap. Heaven's Roadmap, brother. We've got geography. Geography tells us how to get someplace. Heaven is the capital of the kingdom of God. You and I are the kingdom of God. Amen. We're God's hands extended down here now. Amen. It's already started, brother. I want you to know the spirit of Antichrist is already loosed in the world today. Well, what does that mean, Pastor? That means that he's smarter than you are, and he can detect in a heartbeat quicker than you can whether you got eyes going in two different directions or not. Being mean or mad, I'm trying to tell you. Don't let the devil dangle a carrot.
Right.
Amen.
Everything you do, let it be with heaven in view. Everything you do, let it be for your Lord.
Amen.
Let it be that you may glorify the Lord. Amen. One commentator said, the Bible is God's guidebook. The church is his weekly parade for those who belong to it, to the kingdom of God and the body of Christ. The kingdom of God is within us. Amen. The kingdom of God is righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. Amen. What are you saying? I'm trying to say, if we're living for God and we don't have joy, I look at some of you 2 or 3 times and I smile real big and I try to, you know, I do everything but do this, trying to get you to realize you're on your way to heaven, not hell. You got the joy of the Lord, not a spirit of confusion. Amen. You got something that's supposed to be contagious. You got something that God gave you that the devil can't take away. Hey, brother, it's a time to rejoice. It's a time to shout in the Lord. I don't know how long we'll be able to get together and come together, but when we get through coming together down here, brother, we're going to get together up there. And it's going to be the devil give you a sourpuss attitude. Don't choose to be down in the mully grubs. Amen. There's geography. There's arithmetic. There's adding and subtracting. Geography. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. I'm about to forget my thought here. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. That's what we're supposed to be seeking. Right. First is the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God. Amen. 6 and 33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Therefore I say unto you, verse 25, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet what for your body, what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? Behold, the fowls of the air, they sow not, neither do they reap, nor they gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? And it goes on, and he just further ratifies. I mean, we can't change our height. We can't change our structure. I almost said width. We can't change so many things we seem to not be able to change. Hallelujah. Some of them we really could change if we had a desire. I'm taking metformin for diabetes. And I just happened to stop yesterday. I don't know if Brother Nick was with me at this time or not. I stopped and got gas after. But anyway, I just happened to go in and I just happened to get me some almond M&Ms because almonds are good for you.
Yeah.
And while I was there, I went on and got me a Mars bar. And I checked my sugar this morning and it was right where it's supposed to be. But they're still in the package. When are they not going to be where they're supposed to be? When is the numbers not going to be where it's supposed to be? When I get this appetite under control. When I watch and guard what puts in my mouth, what goes in my mouth. I can blame everybody. It's metformin's fault. It's the doctor's fault. It's the church's fault. Y'all just stressing me out. It's my wife's fault. I've used it. That's a broken record there. She got to where she is doing this. Folks, we're going to heaven. Amen. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Then all these things shall be added unto you. And what gave me this thought is one of the commentaries was talking about addition and subtraction and multiplication and division. And I was already on this train of thought and I just thought that would work perfect. You know, there's more to being a Christian,
yes, sir,
than meets the eye.
Right.
But sometimes you got to let God help you with your perspective.
Amen.
Sometimes you just don't think the way he thinks. I mean, it's not always that our minds are spiritual, but God wants them to be.
Yes.
He wants them to be. He wants to help us. Amen. But he's going to add unto us the things that we need. And all these things shall be added unto you. A lot of people are trying to get God to add his blessings unto their life. But it's hard for God to bless a double-minded man or woman. A double-minded boy or girl. I admonish you that are young people today. Make your mind up early you're going to serve God. And go on and commit. Go
yes,
on and die the death. Make your mind, I'm going to serve God.
Yes,
I'm going to go to heaven.
Right.
I don't care if the devil offered me 100 years down here. And let me tell you, there is no way there's 100 years left.
Come on.
I don't see that. I'm telling you, it's been a long time since 1948, I believe, when Israel became a nation. And this generation shall not pass. So when we're already getting close to 70 years or whatever, maybe already there, we got to be faithful. We got to be faithful. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things, what things? These things, as he says, all these things shall be added unto you. What things are the devil trying to steal? What things are the devil using to try to hinder and distract you and I from going to heaven? It's these things that he tells us, amen, to take no thought for. Take no thought for the food. Take no thought for the clothes. He's not telling you to just get out there and just lay down in the yard and expect God to feed you and clothe you and find a bridge or a porch to get in under somewhere. But he's trying to tell you, he's taking better care of the sparrows. He's taking better care of the fowls. He's taking better care of everybody and everything than you can take care of yourself with all of your effort. But yet we don't trust him. We don't trust him a lot of times. If we put a ship out in the ocean and just we're headed to the other side of the sea and we take the captain there and everything, and all of a sudden now we take the helm and just take it off the boat, and it's windy and there's gusts and there's waves and there's turbulent and everything, you can have a pretty chart. You can have a plan that's real nice. But if somebody is not guarding that boat, if somebody is not directing and keeping that boat on course, that boat is going to drift. You know, God will keep you in the straight and narrow if you'll let him. God will lead you and guide you. But, you know, a lot of times you do things and you don't think about them. Therefore, I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body what ye shall put on. Is not life more than meat and the body than raiment? There was a boy over in another country, and he was working with a guy that was, I think he was working on telegraph lines, and he hired on, and he was just a helper, I guess, and they were all getting ready to go, and it was almost quitting time, and they told the boy to snip some wires and then come on down the ladder, and they were up four stories in the air, and told him to come on down the ladder, and don't forget the tools. Be sure and take the tools back to the shop. Don't leave any of them up there, because you can't just go down to Ace Hardware and Walmart and whatever like you can today. But after they left, this boy slipped and fell four stories. And there was a woman that had a rope out there for a clothesline, and he caught that rope right in his rib cage. It knocked him unconscious. She came out thinking he was a drunk and began to shake him and everything and tell him he needs to come to his senses and everything. And she took off and went looking for the police. Her clothes were all over, scattered all over the yard and everything. And he was dazed and everything and come to himself. And he shook himself and gathered himself and kind of wondered what happened. And he went back up that ladder and went to gather them tools. Gathered the tools and come back down the ladder four stories. And when he got to the bottom of the ladder to the ground, he passed out. Just like he was dead. He wasn't dead. The policeman got there and realized it was an emergency situation and got him to the hospital or infirmary or whatever it was that he went to. And the boy was okay. But the point the commentary was trying to make was when he come to, it was on his conscious mind to please the Father. Yeah. I can't remember if the owner was the dad. I can't remember, but to please the Father.
Yeah.
To get the tools like he was asked to get.
Yeah.
To do what he was asked to do.
Yeah.
But I'm telling you, if we're not careful, I mean, we're kind of like that man Brother Gregory was telling me about. He's there in service and this well-known guy, good godly guy, was sleeping through service, and his friend punched him and said, "The pastor's wanting you to dismiss in prayer." And he jumped up and started dismissing in prayer right in the middle of the pastor's preaching. He was disoriented. Let me tell you, y'all wonder why y'all love Brother Gregory so much today. is because you don't know how mischievous he used to be. Brother Gregory was working with a young man one time. I don't know what this has got to do anything, but I'll tell it since I thought of it. Help me to know what to tell when I think of it and what not to tell. Brother Gregory told this guy this jalapeno pepper was a pickle. And he told him to eat it. And he ate it and it set him on fire. And he was complaining and everything. He said, if you'll take that pickle and you'll rub it all over your lips,
oh, no.
The burning in your mouth will go away. Well, it did, compared to the burning in his lips. God will never do you that way. That is not the nature of God in Brother Gregory. He's changed a whole lot since then. Amen? But that's what God's got to deal with. Amen, in us humans. But I'm going to tell you what, if we'll trust God, we'll have the best life now. Not according to Joel Osteen's standard, but according to the Word of God. He'll give you as much as He can trust you with. He'll bless you as much as He can depend upon you to do with it what needs to be done for the kingdom. God help us to think first about God and eternity before we think about the pleasures of sin for a season. If it's always on our mind to do something that grieves the heart of God, we're not thinking about heaven. We're thinking about the here and now. And the Bible says, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also.
Yes.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. Amen.
Amen.
If the kingdom of God is on your heart and mind. There's another point here. There's geography. There's numbers and arithmetic, and there's grammar. And I put this one in for our grammar teachers. Said, what is a verb? Seek. Seek, what mood is it in? It's an imperative mood. It's in the imperative mood. It is a thing that must be done because we are commanded to do it by the Lord Jesus Christ. We must seek first the kingdom of God. You can't just keep putting it off. Do you hear what I'm saying? You can't keep putting it off. You can't keep getting distracted.
Right.
You can't keep making bad choices and expecting good results.
Right.
If you're having trouble in your life, you need to go to the Lord and ask Him why. And He may not give you an answer right now. You may be having trouble because it's in God's plan. Job was having trouble, not because of Job's sin, but because God wanted to encourage us, I guess.
Yeah.
God had a greater plan, but God gave Job double, amen, for his trouble. Amen?
Amen.
In 2 Timothy 4 and 3 says, for the time, let me read 4 and 5. Says, but watch thou in all things, endure affliction, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. Paul is admonishing Timothy, amen, to in everything, basically, endure afflictions, endure all things, amen, watch in all things, be faithful to God. Why? Because he said, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine.
Right.
There's coming a perilous time upon the world. There's coming a time that even worse than what it is now. They will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. They shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned into fables. And the devil wants you to think that's going to happen to everybody but you. Just because that boy fell off that four-story house, lived, and everything turned out okay, he may have had some aches and pains later on in his life that he didn't have to have.
Right.
That's right.
But watch thou. Who? You. Watch your life. Watch who you run with. Watch what you think. And what in everything. In everything. Endure affliction. You're going to undergo some hardships. People are turning away their ears from the truth. What's he saying? He said, you know, you're more ready to hear God There are some of my kids that are here today. You're more ready to hear God today, except for the grace of God, than you may be tomorrow. I've never seen people in church stay the same. I've pastored people that were in their early 20s that got married, and the husband would want to be faithful to God and the wife wouldn't, and the wife would want to be faithful to God 6 months later and the husband wouldn't, and they would yin-yang and back and forth and undecided until they were filing for divorce. Moved away. You hear 6, 8 months, a year, 2 years later, oh, they got divorced. They moved for a big raise instead of a good church. Paul said, "For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I've fought a good fight. I've finished my course. I've kept the faith." You know, you must exercise vigilance in this life. Watch thou in all things. You must be patient, trust in God, endure afflictions. You got to be active in aggressive mission work and reaching out to others. Do the work of an evangelist. And you must leave nothing undone that will advance the truth of God. Make full proof of thy ministry. Why? Because Jesus told you to. If the devil can get you to worry about the confusion, about the stuff that's going on in the world, he can work on your love. He can begin to get you to find fault and see things with them that reasons why you shouldn't necessarily love them. There's plenty of reasons why you shouldn't love me or them in the natural, but not in the spiritual. In the spiritual, you're to endure.
Right.
You to turn the other cheek. Some of y'all read that about Stephen and him scoffing him and mocking him and gnashing at him with his teeth, with their teeth and everything. And you think it's no big deal because it's not me. But what if it were you?
Right.
Could you love him? Verse 8 says, "Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing." What's he saying? He said, "Take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body more than raiment? I take care of the fowls, and I'll take care of you. You can't add one cubit to your stature. Amen. Consider the lilies. They toil not, neither do they spin. Yet Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of them." What God's saying is, don't live with this in view. Live with that in view. Realize you're a child of the King.
Amen.
Your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You are an heir and a joint heir. God has given you the signet ring, so to speak.
Yes.
And he said, "Whatsoever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven."
Right.
And whatsoever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Praise the Lord. Are you ready to go to heaven? Did you know January the 6th of 1980, I was in a service and I sat back there and I decided I didn't want to go to hell. I didn't decide that I loved God. I didn't decide that I was holy. I didn't decide that I deserved grace. I didn't decide that everything was perfect in my life. I didn't decide that I was ever going to make it. But I decided I wanted to go to heaven. And I came down and I knelt and prayed and said, "God, if you'll help me, I'll serve you."
Amen.
I'm not feeling like I had a whole lot of faith, to be honest with you. But I felt like I better grab that log because I was going down a stream.
Right.
And I did. And that was 40 years I'm still serving the Lord. I couldn't get to 3-4 weeks before that.
Right.
But I just kept trying and kept trying. And I'm telling you, Brother Chase, Brother Andrew, Brother Matt, Sister Kaylee, Sister Hannah, our young people, our not so young people, our old people, and our real old people, we can make it. If we don't
Amen.
Give up,
Amen.
We can make it. I've been in that fairly young group. I've been in that not so young group. And now I'm in that old group. And I'm encouraged. And I wouldn't turn back the hands of time for $1 million. God knows I'm telling the truth. It's a good life living for the Lord. I'm not saying you don't have some troubles. But you got a friend that's walking with you through those troubles. Amen.
Amen.
You got a friend in the Lord.
Yes, sir.
You got a friend in me. Amen.
Amen.
I was saying that young boy that was carrying his brother there, and he said, "Don't he get heavy?" He said, "He ain't heavy, mister. He's my brother."
Right. Amen.
We love our brothers and sisters in the Lord.
Amen.
But the devil wants you to get you think that they don't love you, that we don't love you. But we do. We love you. Amen. Would you stand this morning? Pray as we're praying just now. Father, I pray, God, that you help everyone here, Lord, to make a fresh commitment, Lord, to surrender to you. Help us to surrender greater than we've ever surrendered before, Lord. Help us to love you like you deserve to be loved. Lord, to be faithful to you. Lord, we don't know how to go out or come in. We don't know what to do. Many times, God, we're just prodding along, Lord, seeming like that we're not really accomplishing. We're not really getting where we want to get. But God, help us to occupy faithfully until you come to get us. I pray these that are struggling, Lord, that they would hold on and not be weary in well-doing. I pray that they would not be discouraged and not be offended, Lord. But God, I pray that they would sell out and commit, and we would have a greater love for you. Please help us. Be merciful to us, Lord. Use us and keep us, I pray, Lord. Touch Sister Jackie's brother. Touch my precious sister, Sister Cindy, Lord. Let her feel your love. Encourage her, Lord, and let her see you're a strengthener. You're a deliverer, Lord. You can help. God, you can help the back. You can help the twist. You can help all that, Lord. You can ease the pain. Minister, Lord. Touch our loved ones and help me to be the Christian, the husband, the dad, the pastor that you want me to be. And God, help each of us in that area. And we'll give you praise in Jesus' name. Come get us, Lord Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Choose not to be happy here and now for a season, but choose to be happy forever with God.